present a joint military demonstration featuring both active and reserve components of the Army, Air Force, and Marines. The first demonstration will showcase various ways to place our military ground forces into operational areas using both fixed and rotary winged aircraft. The first portion of the demonstration will be conducted by a reconnaissance platoon from the United States Marine Corps' 4th Reconnaissance Company using United States Air Force C-130 Hercules aircraft from the 337th pass to portray a military static line parachute jump. The navigator will turn on the green light and the 1st Marine will exit through the visible rear troop door. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a Marine 4th Recon platoon. You should count approximately 23 jumpers in the air. Insertion technique that can be used by Army Rangers and other ground forces in order to enter operational areas where the vegetation prevents landing. The helicopters will come to a hover directly in front of the bleachers at a height of approximately 60 feet. The cadet Rangers will slide to the ground as rapidly as possible using 4 nylon ropes that are temporarily anchored in and deployed from the aircraft's cargo compartment.
two Thunderbird solo pilots have broken out of position for their opening maneuvers, and the Diamond formation is now pulling into the vertical with minimum wingtip clearance for maneuver call the Cloverloop. As the team comes over the top at minimum airspeed and begins the backside of the maneuver, notice the leader smoothly and gracefully turn the entire Diamond to exit to your right.
Thank you.
taking. Crossover break. Watch as all four aircraft execute simultaneous aileron roll. With the other four pilots, they are positioning themselves in the same formation called the Thunderbird Five Guard. And now, the Thunderbird for the intricate Five Guard loop. Maintain a very precise position and is completely surrounded by his teammates.
clear left. The Thunderbirds are now approaching for one of their most popular maneuvers, the bomb burst. As the team passes in front of you, they will begin their pull-up in order to be straight up directly above a point located 4,000 feet to your right. Let's watch as the team pulls up and then breaks to the 4 points of the compass, followed close behind by Thunderbird 5, who will spiral into the sky.
From your right for the Delta Pass review. Lieutenant Colonel Riggs and the entire Thunderbird team wish to dedicate this pass to all the great people here at the Reno Air Races today.
As all six red, white, blue Thunderbird aircraft pass before you today, they represent the spirit of our American heritage. With a nation in its third century of progress, the American dedication to freedom continues. To your left, the Delta formation is pulled into the vertical to reposition for the Delta roll.
Thunderbird leader has just called for the Delta Cloverleaf, the closing maneuver for today's demonstration. Watch as the beautiful Delta formation gracefully turns as if welded together, resembling a giant waterfall cascading from the sky. Levels out, they were running straight towards you as they pass over the top and exit the demonstration area. We'd like to take this opportunity to say thank you, and we hope you enjoyed the flying demonstration. Thank you.
Position, go into the horizontal position, streamlining themselves with the fuselage, reducing the aerodynamic drag that they are creating at this time.
As Bill picks up the speed on the 450 Stearman, they'll get some lift out of their bodies and actually be able to fly, get a very independent feeling out in front of the airplane. Now, Bill, turning around to the right, as he comes back in, believe this or not, it'll be Kathy Rivas on our side. While Bill has turned around, she has stood on her head. So as Bill comes in from the right, watch Kathy to be standing upside down with her head on the top of the bottom. This is the Kathy Rivas headstand. Straight on to us now. Bill diving the airplane down to the maximum speed for the Stearman, 186 knots. And you'll be able to see the daring damsels off to the left and off to the right. As right about in here, everybody pulls about 3.5 to 4 G's. Back on the stick, and everybody goes upside down. Back down off the half cubit eight. Now, Bill will come back in from the right this time. As he does, keep your eyes very closely between the wings, and you'll see the daring damsels, Connie and Kathy, move out from their position, which is halfway between the fuselage and the wing tip. They'll move out to the inner plane strut. They'll do it exactly the same time, so to create the same aerodynamic drag in the same place on the fuselage to make Bill's job just a little bit easier. There they're starting to move out now, and they are out with that 1, 2, 3 step right out of the wing at this time.
The wing walking 360. Now, Bill, once again, we'll turn around to our left, and at this time, this is our chance to be able to acknowledge at least one half of the wing walking duo. It will be Connie Warren on our side again. She'll be standing up on the top of the bottom wing, leaning way out, holding on with one arm and waving with the other. You can believe that. So as they come back in, let's get ready. Take those hats off, wave the programs right about in here. Let's give her a big wave. Take your hats off, there she is. Now you'll see her waving out front there, hanging on with just one hand. That's Connie Warren's lean out.
Nevada Highway at 55 or 60 miles an hour. The window of your car or truck down, you extend your arm out, and you know the tremendous amount of wind force that's on your arm. Well, picture that, or try to imagine that, if you will, all over your entire body, not at speeds of 55 or 60, but speeds upwards of 200 miles an hour. Add to that the chill factor of those speeds, and you can see exactly what the girls have to put up with. Now, as they come back in, it'll be Kathy Rivas on our side, and she will be doing what we call the scissors. She will be once again in line with the fuselage, arms and legs extended, scissors in the open position.
Looking for about 170, 175, 180, 185. Back on the stick, everybody.
Get down on that wing.
Yeah.
side down position, around the barrel, and right side up once again. And Bill will be flying right side up. Kathy and Connie will be upside down as they come in off to the right about this time. This is, of course, the double knee hang. They have moved to that position now, upside down once again. They are looking forward, hanging upside down. The knees are right at the leading edge of the wing.
And there are the streamers we talked about. But he'll roll the Big Thunder Stearman upside down. The girls will be sitting upright, sitting on the bottom portion of the bottom wing with the girls flying upside down. Okay, now comes the dive once again to pick up the extra speed. We'll get the half roll from Bill. The girl's still upside down. Bill's still right side up, and that's all going to change right here as he does the big roll. Tilts it up. Now the girls are sitting right side up. Bill's upside down. He says, okay, it's not so easy after all.
They get the good ride right in here as they are sitting up. Now everything's going to change at the 90-degree position. Everybody moves around once again and assumes a position back on the wings for the landing. Thunder Stearman is down on the ramp, and Kathy and Connie are taking a well-deserved rest, sitting on the wings after moving around there. Well, let's give them a tribute. A lot of us have been on the field for an hour and a half or 2 hours. We might want to stretch anyway. Let's all stand up, all up and down the line. Let's everybody take a little stretch.
Big giant C5 in the air, and it's Captain Sonny Everett of U.S. Air will tell you, keep a look out at that landing gear down there. As it comes up, it will turn 90 degrees to streamline on the fuselage right about in here as they start to bring it up.
Then it gets tucked up inside of that landing gear well, as their speed is back to about 160 miles per hour on this particular run, the down and dirty run, as we call it, which, by the way, is no reflection on the airplane or the pilot. It just means that the landing gear and the flaps, all the drag items, are down. We'll be making another pass with the C5A, and this time he'll pick up the speed a little bit.
Are you ready for this? He can hold 421,000 cases of beer. Not just any beer.
But nice beer. Look at that.
There it goes.
A race horse start in the Formula One bronze, and the flag has been dropped, and the airplane's now creeping out very slowly as they go from static RPM, and the pilots release the brakes. Stick goes forward now. That tail comes up as soon as possible. The airplane's now going around. The only purebred racers in the world, the mighty Formula Ones, are in the air. And as we look out to our left, coming by on a streak, and we'll get a time on him. As he comes by, I believe it looks like Bobby Buddy, number 10. 19, that's George Buddy. And right behind him is brother Bobby Buddy. And then the all-yellow airplane of Phil Hibbler, I believe. And then Gary Hubler. And then Dave Morris. No, I believe I had Dave Morris in the wrong spot. Change him around with Hibbler. And then Dave Morris and Robert Reed. Okay, now picking up the airplanes on the backstretch. As you can see, George Buddy, after making that engine change, making no bones about it, that he is going to have to be the one that they're going to catch in that first place. And in back of him, his brother, Bobby Buddy, at number 10, El Bandito. So it's George Buddy and what he fondly calls the Okie Streaker out in the lead right now. Coming around, that pylon 6 will be the first lap down. We'll have a time on it for you. Just as soon as he passes by and we can get it computed. These are unofficial, but we have been running very, very close on our times with the official timer. Okay, George Buddy goes by. Bobby Buddy at number 10. As the airplane's going to that number 1 pylon. So let's see if Hubler can hang in there on the outside, flying a little bit higher. And here's where he'll trade off some of that altitude for airspeed. He comes around, pylon number 3. Moving up now, that's him down low. As he goes by Ray Cassett at number 20,
now picks off Robert Reed right there, coming in now to that number five pylon. Zero time engine out there, and it is probably picking up a lot of heat because they didn't have time to really make a decent break-in or run-in with that engine. Okay, that was lap number six.
Now, pushing forward on that nose. Will he get past the airplane right there in front of him with Phil Hilbert? He does. And the checkered flag comes out for George Buddy in the Oki Streaker. And we had a 211-mile-an-hour lap on seven, and he finished up with a 208-mile-per-hour average for that eight-lap race. And from them, they accelerate quite fast to around 80. But right here, especially for the airplanes in the rear, have a tough time with that vortex coming off those wingtips.
Now, let's see if that brand new zero-time engine at number 44, Sitting Duck, is going to be able to cut the mustard here as they come across.
And that lead airplane looks like it's number 32, Errol Johnstead. And right in back of him, wasting no time at all with that brand new engine, is Alan Preston in Sitting Duck. And then Vince Tyrrell, Rocky Jones up high, Tom Summers, followed by Bill Sklar. And then 41 Terry and Carl Swenson in his airplane, the Ann. Okay, picking him up on the backstretch. And it's going to be a real race out there between Alan Preston and Errol Johnstead. Johnstead having a very light airplane, getting off the ground first, as you could see, but that streak of burnt orange with a silver tail. And they accelerate quite fast to around 80. But right here, especially for the airplanes in the rear, have a tough time with that vortex coming off those wingtips.
Now, let's see if that brand new zero-time engine at number 44, Sitting Duck, is going to be able to cut the mustard here as they come across.
And that lead airplane looks like it's number 32, Errol Johnstead. And right in back of him, wasting no time at all with that brand new engine, is Alan Preston in Sitting Duck. And then Vince Tyrrell, Rocky Jones up high, Tom Summers, followed by Bill Sklar. And then 41 Terry and Carl Swenson in his airplane, the Ann. Okay, picking him up on the backstretch. And it's going to be a real race out there between Alan Preston and Errol Johnstead. Johnstead having a very light airplane, getting off the ground first, as you could see, but that streak of burnt orange with a silver tail. The famous airplane that we have seen so many times before, one time called Judy's Turn, starts turning it on now. So we'll get one lap speed for you as they come around start-finish line at this time. It's going to be interesting to see if the Sitting Duck, as Alan Preston calls it, will be able to overtake that lead airplane off the scatter pylon in the first lap. And will he do it? He's coming up on him and he's pressed. Start-finish line, they do.
And he has got the one lap here. We'll get a time for you in just a moment.
We had a speed on that last lap of Alan Preston, 230.80 miles an hour. And there we get a pass as he finally gets past Rocky Jones, Bill Sklar, right here from Reno, Nevada.
And so that's Sklar. But once again, Sklar having to go out wide. Rocky Jones looks like he regained that third place position for just a moment, and then having it taken away from him as they rolled out of pylon number three.
Lenny, as you can see, ladies and gentlemen, on the takeoff roll from your right, flying the Evergreen T-28, Robert A. Bob Huber. I'm sure no one needs an introduction to this great aviator, but nonetheless, I'm sure we have some new people in the stands today. This may be their first air race, air show, so I'll tell you and them something about this great fellow and the aircraft as he's flying, as he opens up with his traditional roll off takeoff. Bob, of course, one of the few people that participated in the first and all of the air races here at Reno, starting out in 1964. Today, Bob will be flying, in addition, of course, to his starting the unlimited and flying safety cover, he'll be flying the T-28B, which is in now, and also the Sabreliner. Now, we're going to keep an eye on the nose of the aircraft and also the angle of the wing so we can tell what Bob's going to do, because he's just sort of having a good time out there, sort of freewheeling, you might say. Nose coming up and away from us. One, over to the inverted, point two. Continuing around, point three, and to the upright, point four, as Bob completes the four-point sectional or hesitation roll. Down to the right-hand portion. Now, Bob will probably go right into the second half of that. Eight. Looks like it's going to be an inside or barnstormer's loop. You'll notice about 5/8 of the way over the top, you'll start a series of rolls. He'll roll the aircraft a couple of times on that down line, completing his version of the Cuban 8 or 8 on its side. Now, some of you might not be aware that that maneuver that Bob is doing out there now came into being quite by accident. Back in 1936 down in Miami, Florida, during an aerobatic competition, since that time, all aerobatic and competition pilots have used one or more versions of the Cuban 8. Now, Bob over the top in the old country loop, the barnstormer's loop, inside loop, whichever you like to have it called. Now, this is the first aerobatic maneuver ever performed by an aerobatic pilot. Performed the 25th of November, 1913, out in San Francisco, California, not too far from here. Coming down the line, ladies and gentlemen, the Thunderbirds, 1986. Let's have our hats off to the Thunderbirds. Give them a big wave and a loud round of real applause to the Thunderbirds, 1986. T-28B, rolling it on the vertical, that is the Thunderbirds, 1986. Bob coming down now, that Chinese devilman. Okay, Bob has a T-28B in the landing configuration. This time indicates that he's probably going to settle that right in for his landing. Sandy looks like he's going to slide right in there very, very gracefully with the T-28B, and you've got a bunch of charges out there just all getting set to go.
United States National Aerobatic Champion and 1980 World Aerobatic Champion Leo Loudenswager with a little wave hello right there in knife edge flight. Back on the stick he goes and right on up over the top. We'll get halfway around the loop to an Immelman in a series of rolls right in here going back to the right side of the aerobatic area. There's one complete roll. Here comes number two. There's three. And four. And five. He'll stop it right there in the inverted attitude, pushing forward on the stick now. Negative G's. An outside maneuver as he comes up there and across the top. Watch roll on top of the inside country style loop. Slowing up to about 105 to 110 miles an hour at the top and accelerating down to 185 or 190 as he comes right through the center of the aerobatic area. Once again, up on the vertical line, a series of slow rolls on the way up. He'll get right up there, kicking it across the top, and a series of rolls on the way back down into the tailspin, if you will. He'll stop it right about there on runway heading. He'll also incorporate a little bit of a wind correction angle in there, as you'll see that as the wind is affecting many of the performers. There's one, two, three, and four. The four-point hesitation roll followed by the slow roll. We are now going back on the stick. Now watch as he gets up in here, 5/8 of the way around the inside loop. He'll grab a point, a reference point on the ground, and 1.5 outside step rolls to the right side up position, coming right back down to air show center once again. Comes back on the stick. There's the first corner of the inside square loop. He'll get right up there. Here's the second corner, incorporating the wind correction angle, coming across the top, flying upside down in the inverted attitude for a little while. There's the third corner of the inside square loop, and coming right straight down now for the fourth corner. Perfectly square loop in the sky. Leo now going out to the left side of the aerobatic area. Straight up on the vertical up line, 1 and 2 points. There's number 3 and 4. A 4-point hesitational on the vertical up line. Again, he'll get right up there. Now watch for the hammerhead turn. Full left rudder and a little bit of right aileron coming right straight back down the same line that he went up with a snap roll on the way back down. Leo accelerating in airspeed now, converting the altitude into airspeed up to about 200 miles per hour as he passes across the start-finish line. The octagon loop, there's side number 2. Number 3 on the diagonal going across. Number 4 upside down in the inverted attitude, holding it there for a second. Number 5 on the diagonal right down. Number 6 and number 7 right in here. And number 8. The octagon loop, the 8-sided inside loop. 1980 World Aerobatic Champion Leo Loudenswigger, recipient of the Victor Award, along with such athletic greats as O.J. Simpson and Bjorn Borg. The only pilot, the only person in aviation to receive the Victor Award thus far. With 1, 2.5 inside snap rolls to the inverted attitude. Watch this. A 360-degree turn.
Knife edge configuration, doing a full 360-degree turn the hard way. About 4 times his weight in G-forces, trying to push him outside and away from the airplane through that entire maneuver. Again, a series of rolls going out to the left. Once again, up and over the top. This time it'll be 5/8 of the way around the inside loop. He'll establish the diagonal line, coming right back down. Now watch this as he gets right in here. There's 1, 2, 3, and 4. A 4-point hesitation roll, inverted to inverted. Very quickly, once again, pushing forward on the stick. He'll come around the outside and up and over the top. Leo gets right up there. Now watch as he rolls it all the way around. Holds it in the inverted attitude for a moment. Upside down, and it continues around the inside portion. That's the outside inside loop. Leo now leading the outside inside loop and going out to the right-hand side of the air show zone. He'll quickly come back on the stick and straight up into the sky once again. He'll continue right on up there. We're going to see a hammerhead now from the side as we get right up here. Now he's decided, because of the wind, he's going to do across the aerobatic area that way, and that way he can compensate for the wind drift that he is experiencing up there. And as he comes right back down through the center of the air show zone once again, he'll get right in here. Now watch this little series of maneuvers. As we get right here, the smoke comes on. He rolls it around. There's 1. Full slow roll. Now how about here? The double inside snap roll. 3/4 of the way around this way, the other direction. And now he goes, stops it right there. And now an outside 3/4 snap roll followed by an outside 3/4 snap roll. Right there. You put it all together, you call it the computer roll. Leo now coming back across the top. He'll get right up there, establishing the inverted attitude for a moment. Again, rolling the airplane around right side up and building in the wind correction angle on the way back down. Leo comes right into the center of the air show area with the Bud Light Laser 200. Back on the stick he goes, straight up. Now watch this as he continues to roll the airplane, going straight up into the sky. Watch the airplane against the clouds in the background as he'll stop going straight up, start coming straight back down while still rolling the airplane. It's called the torque roll. There's 1.25 times around, about 1.5 times around. It's called the torque roll. Into the tailspin on the way back down and recovering perfectly on the heading of the aerobatic area. Once again now, Leo comes straight up on the vertical lap line. He'll get right up there, pull back across the top, and once again convert that altitude into airspeed, the constant exchange, trade-off, if you will. Trading airspeed for altitude or altitude for airspeed. As Leo comes right back into show center now once again, he'll get right here, straight up. Now watch this. This is called the Cobra Roll. There's the tail of the snake, and here comes the head. There's one, and two, and three, and four. Oh, how about five all the way around? Five snap rolls. Two going up and three coming down. He'll get right up there. Watch this nice little hammerhead. We get right up in here now. Full left rudder. A little bit of left aileron and straight back down the same line that he went up. Leo now with the quarter roll on the way back down. He'll come right through the center of the air show zone. Again, up around 210 to 215 miles per hour. He comes back on the stick. Very nice, very smooth as he comes right around here. Gets right up. Now watch this. Three quarters of a snap roll up on top, across the top of the loop in knife edge flight, and then a quarter roll to the inverted position, extend it just a little bit to compensate for the wind, and then come all the way around. That's called the loop with a Leo twist. As he goes out to the right-hand side of the aerobatic area once again, Leo come right on up to the top of this vertical climb. He'll get right up there, and I watch he'll push forward out the top of this, fly out the top, if you will. Get right up in here, very quickly pushing over, changing heading by 90 degrees in the process, and then a three-quarter snap roll on the way back down. Leo comes right down to show center once again. He'll have a lot of airspeed through here, about 220 miles per hour. Pulling back on the stick, a nice vertical climb. Now let's watch right in here, see if we can get a tail slide. No, it's going to be the four-point hammerhead turn. There's one and two. Here comes number three. And there's number four right there, coming right straight down with a one and a quarter snap roll on the vertical down line. Leo now coming right back through the center of the aerobatic area. Goes out to the left-hand side of the air show zone. Again, he'll come back on the stick. Straight up. One, two, and the three-quarter snap roll going around. Now he's going to continue to do the what he calls the weird series of snap rolls. It's really about three and a third snap rolls on the way up, and he changes direction by 180 degrees, and now does a half roll on the way back down. He gets right here at show center once again, back on the stick. Now watch the vertical climbing capability of the Bud Light Laser 200. Half of a loop there, now pushing forward, doing half of an outside loop at top. At the top, even at these high-density altitudes, the Bud Light Laser still has the great vertical climb performance for only 200 horsepower of going all the way up there. Now watch for the wingtip smoke to come on. Out on each wingtip, we'll see the smoke come on out there. And Leo is going to get set to perform a maneuver called the Lomshavak, which means headache or tumble or somersault in Czechoslovakian slang language, they say. And let's watch for Leo as he comes down around here. Get your cameras ready on this one if you have motor drive or slow motion. It is ready. As Leo comes right back here, he'll establish the diagonal line on the way up, all the way around. Now push the button right in here. End over end, tail over nose. Somersaulting through the sky one time around, two times around, and now into the tail spin right there with about a three-quarter turn, correcting very nicely on the heading of the runway. Going right out to the left-hand side now. Leo is observing the wind very, very closely because he's getting set to perform an attempt to cut the ribbon with the propeller of the airplane. You look out on the runway, you can see his ground crew set up out there with the ribbon on two poles that are 14 feet high. Leo is going to attempt to cut that ribbon, little red ribbon, in between those poles while flying upside down at a speed of about 175 miles per hour. Direct 90-degree crosswind, looking at the flag. Right here, the flag's up on top. It is dived down just a little bit, but that can always change within a matter of seconds. But nonetheless, it is 90 degrees across the runway. He rolls over upside down. The wheels are on the top. He is inverted upside down. He's lining up with the edge of the runway right now, and he's going to go out there and try to cut that ribbon. As he gets right about in here, now he gets right in here, a few last-minute adjustments, and wow, he got it right through there, and the snap roll on the way up. How about that? Ladies and gentlemen, Leo Loudenslager and the Bud Light Laser 200. Keep your eye on this. This is his signature trademark, if you will. As he will go out to the right-hand side, the aerobatic area. going to set up. Now, this is his downwind leg for landing. Those of you who are pilots know what I'm talking about when I say the downwind leg. He goes vertical. There's a half roll. Then comes back on the stick, performs a split S maneuver. And he will come right on down through here as he gets set up. Now, here is his base leg. It's called a loop. Back around with the loop, country style loop, and then he will come right back around here and do a roll. Watch this now, he'll do a slow roll after completion of the loop. Right in here, we're going to do one, stop it right at there, 1 1/4, stop it in a side slip, and get set to touchdown on the runway. Drives tower controllers nuts.
Thank you. the very, very slow speed handling characteristics of the F-18. This is absolutely amazing. Look at the angle of attack on the airplane. It's not necessarily that they can fly. We're showing that the airplane is extremely stable throughout all airspeed.
Indicator.
are unwinding. As things get very slow, there's the shift into reverse. With one, two, three, three and a half lengths of the tail slide, you hear the power come back in right about here. Now, if you want to get the cameras ready, you've seen that maneuver.
Turn, and then 2 points of a 4 on the way down.
down the way in front of Joey's spot.
Waiting for his signal. As soon as Joanne clears the runway, he'll...
Jim is known as the big engine. He names his very beautiful airplane, the pink airplane there, I believe, five.
Time on this time. Giving Jim Foote pass on same time. Remember, see, Carson pulling up on David Booth, but not quite being able to grab that lead away. Some laps as they come around this time. But Preston doesn't want to lose any more ground than he's got now, or he's not going to be able, with the speed of the two airplanes being almost equal, to taking unless somebody makes a mistake on the turn. All right. As they once again go across. Preston here, if he doesn't want to lose that altitude until he actually has to, as they go by, still locked in. Right flag now coming out. It looks like Preston is almost catching. And then this move. Able to hold on. All right, now it will be the Matt Dash down here for the finish line. And here comes Preston. Up to the right, and he's got it wide open all the way, but I don't think he's going to be able to do it. It was close.
I'll tell you what, it's perseverance in this as they go into the pylon turn. Ben Fox.
have one now, a little slight lead, but remember, he's on the outside. And the outside means that he's got to fly a little bit farther away and cover more distance. But he's holding that altitude there. Now, Rex, I think his plan will be, if they come off a pylon ship, he will be pulling it right into the edge of the course and point it downhill just under the bus. Here's where he would like to pass the moving curve, but no, once again, there it went to the side. All right, now as he comes up, now it's alongside, now it passes. Now he wants to get in there, to the left, if he can.
Today, Bob has got for that little puff of smoke from those Buick Goodrich 88 tires as Bob touches
gone out over the top. Now listen to the power reduction as Bob comes over the top of the trike. Okay, power back now. And again, we'll look for that little tunnel smoke from those BF Goodrich 88. It powers on the left side this time. Very gently, Bob. There it is. Okay, touchdown roll and touchdown on the trike. By now, of course, you've all seen the beautiful green and white colors of Evergreen. Bob's going to go out now and make a set of the first time we shot up an engine in the Shrike, Commander. What Bob is going to do is get a little out of the tube that he can convert it to airspeed, and he's going to perform for you a single engine loop. Bob, notice the power on our side. Very quiet on that side of the aircraft. Now, as Bob slides over the top, you'll watch his airspeed very carefully coming down the backside to make sure he has enough for the 8-point roll into the dead engine. Still in the single engine configuration. Bob on the beautiful Evergreen Shrike. Now, as the nose comes up, and the roll will be to his right toward us into the dead engine. There's one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, and eight. Okay, both engines are out for the Shrike, Commander. Now, first point will get to you rather quickly. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, and eight to be inverted. 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, and 16. All right. Very, very crisp. I want you to notice also, ladies and gentlemen, how crisp Bob's point maneuvers always are after he has shut off both engines in the Shrike. You notice he disappeared momentarily down there at Hoover Gulch, but I can see the aircraft making a circle, coming back this way. I look for him to come sneaking up out of the ditch. Now, it was very thought that if they got the famous Bob Hoover to make the Yak 18 fly around the airport battered once and then, of course, tell everyone how great it was, that would be something that they could talk about for a long, long time. But you know, as we have seen Bob, he just doesn't fly the airplane around in a pattern at once. Bob took the Russians' Yak 18, took off, disappeared to the west end of the airport in a riverbed, circled clear around out of sight, reappeared on the east end of the airport, inverted, then put on about 12 minutes of the greatest air show the Russians had ever seen, and of course, Bob was promptly put under house arrest. Okay, Bob getting the altitude he needs now, down to the right-hand portion of the viewing area. He's got another 1,000 feet to go. Okay. One-turn spin, ladies and gentlemen, coming down here from your right. From Los Angeles, California, and Evergreen International, Bob Hoover in his Plane Energy Management Series. All right, both engines are out much. The Shrike Commander very, very quiet. Inside the Shrike, full concentration required by Bob. Okay, those coming up high, high, and high. Okay, this will be the inside or the Barnstormer's loop. First aerobatic maneuver ever performed by an aerobatic pilot on the 25th of November, 1913 in San Francisco, California. Lincoln Beachy was the pilot. Okay, sliding downhill now. You'll monitor his airspeed very, very carefully to make sure he has enough for his 8-point roll. Nose coming up. Inverted. 5, 6, 7, and 8. Okay, there's the inside of the Barnstormer's loop. The 8-point roll. Okay, here's the 180-degree turn. Now, remember, ladies and gentlemen, Bob has to become clear up in front of the narration stand, or it's no bet. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something about it. Here's a man who's been to every relay race for the last 23 years. This week after today, he will have performed 20 performances, 3 unlimited races each day, twice aerobatic routines. Without question, Mr. Helvetica up bottom, and where will the brother see, or probably Edwin will see? Ladies and gentlemen, let's bring Bob Hoover out of the cockpit of that Shrike Commander. Let's stand and all give Bob a lovely, legal welcome. Bob Hoover, ladies and gentlemen. All right, Robert. Well, you notice you have plenty. How about to you and to him, huh? Okay. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Hope everybody's as cold as I am. We came up from sunny Southern California, San Diego, Miramar Naval Air Station. Yes, home of Top Gun. We've all been through the school. Tom Cruise could not make it. Today we will demonstrate the Tomcat's superior speed, agility, power, turning capability, acceleration, and climb capability, which enable it to employ its weapon system and consistently outperform its opponent. Once the aircraft accelerates, rapidly takes off in less than a quarter of a mile. The two engines are developing 24,000 tons of thrust. After takeoff, the center right will execute a high-performance power climb over the field.
Carrier aircraft.
aircraft to slow the aircraft to landing speeds and to set the landing configuration. Wings forward, landing gear down, flaps full down, speed brakes out, and hook down. The F-14's final approach speed is about 125 miles an hour. This relatively slow speed makes the Tomcat a much safer aircraft to land aboard ship by allowing the pilot more reaction time to control his airspeed and rate of descent.
Comes down the backside of this loop, looks about 5 inches.
at the controls, suddenly it becomes an aerobatic aircraft.
We'll watch now as Bob lets the speed build up coming from your left to right. Probably go right into that maneuver we saw in the old lot ago, the T-20 from the Cuban 8 or horizontal 8 to 800 side. Bob, of course, a member of the Society of Experimental Test Pilots, having been president of that on his group on two separate occasions, the only individual ever accorded that great honor. Now, as he always does, his little bit of zest to the 45 or speed line, you notice Bob goes into a series of rolls into the dash 40. As I'm sure you know by now, Bob and I have joined the wonderful family and great organization, Evergreen International Aviation, and we're proud to be a part of that great group. Bob will be flying under the green and white colors from now on.
I'm here rolling again.
Right. And Sandy, our usual number of emergency junctions today are Steve Hampton, 10-year-old Steve Hampton, that's medical trailer, and the guardian there right away. Please, Roger, go to the medical trailer. Thank you.
Really gained a lot of recognition as a support fighter for the long-range bombing mission in Europe.
Oh, yes. Through the vertical, through the 980. Let's take it out.
Hold there.
And once again in the upright position as he streaks by right here at high level. Look at that, ladies and gentlemen. Aircraft left in the world. There's a little knife edge flying.
Stay with me.
Gentlemen, you have a race.
And you heard those famous words. Gentlemen, you have a race. As those mighty unlimiteds come down the stretch.
All right, we have a group of three aircraft in there, very, very tight. As they streak by the number two pylon, three pylon. And
on the hillside, you can barely pick out that white marker of pylon number 4, which the first airplane is at now. And there you see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 airplanes in their very, very sight. The lead airplane having just a little bit of room as they go up to pylon number 5. Now pylon 6 on the hill with the lead plane now. And as they come across their second, third, fourth, fifth, now the sixth place airplane of Lefty Gardner. And the seventh place airplane going by, and the eighth place airplane and ninth place airplane at the pylon 6 now. So that's the separation. We will be tipping a lap speed on these aircraft as they come around with our lead airplane at this point. Coming off of 7, banking into pylon number 8. And it looks like the invasion strikes from the bottom of the airplane for number 91. Did have a problem up there as he was certainly coming out this race. Trying to keep an eye on our airplane engine scrub. Looking at the checkered flag on this lap. Just going by Jimmy McMillan as he laps one more airplane. All right, going by. The wind inside is the way it'll be, and we'll get the lap speed on him. Checkered flag comes down. The drift back for the second time, a gold winner. Ladies and gentlemen, there you have the gold winner.